Dear students, your attention is invited to the lecture number 3 on the subject of atomic physics. We will consider it 3 questions: matter waves, the wave particle duality, third, the uncertainty principle. Maurice de Broglie was a French experimental physicist who from the outset had supported Compton's view on the particle nature of radiation. His experiments and discussions impressed his brother Louis so much with the philosophic problems of physics at the time that Louis changed his career from history to physics. In his doctoral thesis presented in 1924 to the Faculty of Science at the University of Paris, Louis de Broglie proposed the existence of matter waves. The thoroughness and originality of his thesis was recognized at once, but because of the apparent lack of experimental evidence, de Broglie's ideas were not considered to have any physical reality. It was Albert Einstein who recognized their importance and validity and in turn called them to the attention of other physicists. 5 years later, de Broglie won the Nobel Prize in Physics, his ideas having been dramatically confirmed by experiment. The hypothesis of de Broglie was that the dual, that is wave-particle behavior of radiation applies equally well to matter. Just as a photon has a light wave associated with it that governs its motion, so material particles, e.g. an electron, has an associated matter wave that governs its motion. Since the universe is composite entirely of matter and radiation, de Broglie's suggestion is essentially a statement about a grand symmetry of nature. Indeed, he proposed that the wave aspects of matter are related to its particle aspects in exactly the same quantitative way that is the case for radiation. According to de Broglie, for matter and for radiation, alike the total energy E of an entity is related to the frequency nu of the wave associated with its motion by the equation E equals h multiplied nu. And the momentum p of the entity is related to the wavelength lambda of the associated wave by the equation p equals h divided lambda. Here the particle concepts energy E and momentum p are connected through Planck's constant h for the wave concepts frequency nu and the wavelength lambda. Equation 3.1b in the following form is called the de Broglie relation, lambda equals h divided p. It predicts the Broglie wavelength lambda of a matter wave associated with the motion of a material particle having a momentum p. Example 3.1a. What is the de Broglie wavelength of a baseball moving at a speed v equals 10 meters per second. Assume m equals 1 kilogram. From 3.2 equation, lambda equals h divided p. Substituting all volumes, we calculate lambda equals 6.6 multiplied 10 to minus 25 angstrom. B. What is the de Broglie wavelength of a nucleon whose kinetic energy is 100 electron volt? Here, lambda equals h divided p. Substituting all values, we calculated 1.2 multiplied 10 to minus 10 meter equals 1.2 angstrom. The wave nature of light propagation is not revealed by experiments in geometric optics. For the important dimensions of the apparatus used, they are very large compared to the wavelength of light. If it represents a characteristic dimension of an optical apparatus, it is with a lens, mirror or slit, and lambda is the wavelength of the light passing through the apparatus, we are in the domain of geometric optics when lambda divided A tends to zero. The reason is that the diffraction effects in any apparatus are always confined to angles of about theta multiplied theta equals lambda divided A, so diffraction effects are completely negligible when lambda divided A tends to zero. Note that the geometrical optics involves ray propagation, which is similar to the trajectory motion of classical particles. However, when the characteristic dimensions of an optical apparatus becomes comparable to or smaller than the wavelength lambda of the light going through it, we are in the domain of physical optics. In this case, where lambda divided A bigger than 1, the diffraction angle theta equals lambda divided A is a large enough that diffraction effects are easily observed and the wave nature of light propagation becomes apparent. To observe wave-like aspects in the motion of matter, therefore, we need systems with apertures or obstacles in suitably small dimensions. The finest scale systems of apertures available to experimentalists at the time of the Broglie made use the spacing between adjacent planes of atoms in a solid, where A approximately equal 1 angstrom. Considering the de Broglie wavelengths evaluated in example 3.1, we see that they cannot expect to detect any evidence of wave-like motion for a baseball where lambda divided A approximately equals 10 to 25 power for A approximately equal 1 angstrom. But for material particle of very much smaller mass than the baseball, the momentum P is reduced and the de Broglie wavelength lambda equals h divided p is increased sufficiently for diffraction effects to be observable. Using apparatus with characteristic dimensions a equals 1 angstrom, wave-like aspects in the motion of the lambda equals 1.2 angstrom electron of example 2.1 should be very apparent. Elassa pointed out in 1926 that the wave nature of matter might be tested in the same way that the wave nature of X-rays was first tested, namely by allowing a beam of electrons of appropriate energy to fall on the crystalline solid. The atoms of the crystal serve as a three-dimensional array of diffracting centers for the electron wave, and so they should strongly scatter electrons in certain characteristic directions, just as for X-ray diffraction. This idea was confirmed in experiments by Davison and Jamin in the United States and by Thompson in Scotland. Figure 2.1 schematically the apparatus of Davison and Jamin. Electrons from a heated filament are accelerated through a potential difference V and emerge from the electron gun G with kinetic energy E multiplied V. This electron beam falls at normal incidence on the single crystal of nickel at C. The detector D is set as a particular angle theta, and readings of the intensity of the scattered beam are taken at various values of the accelerating potential V. Figure 3.2, for example, shows that a strong scattered electron beam is detected at theta equals 50 degrees for V equals 54 volts. The existence of this peak in the electron scattering pattern demonstrates qualitatively the validity of the de Broglie's postulate, because it can only be explained as a constructive interference of waves scattered by the periodic arrangement of the atoms in two planes of the crystal. Left of the figure, the collector current or detector D of figure 2.1 as a function of the kinetic energy of the incident electrons, showing a diffraction maximum. The angle theta in figure 2.1 is adjusted to 50 degrees. If an appreciably smaller or larger value is used, the diffraction maximum disappears. Right? The current is a function of detector angle for the fixed value of the electron kinetic energy, 54 electron volt. The phenomenon of precisely analogous to the well-known Bragg reflections will occur in the scattering of X-rays from the atomic planes of a crystal. It cannot be understood on the basis of the classical particle motion, but only on the basis of the wave motion. Classical particles cannot exhibit interference, but waves can. The interference involved here is not between a wave associated with one electron and waves associated with another. Instead, it is an interference between different parts of the wave associated with a single electron that have been scattered from various regions of the crystal. This can be demonstrated by using an electron beam of such low intensity that the electrons go through the apparatus one at a time, and by showing that the pattern of the scattered electrons remains the same. Figure 3.3 shows the origin of Bragg reflection, or being the Bragg relation derived as the caption to the figure, n multiplied lambda equals 2 multiplied d multiplied sinus phi. For the conditions on figure 3.3, the effective interplanar spacing d can be shown by X-ray scattering from the same crystal to be 0.91 angstrom. Since that equals 50 degrees, it follows that the phi equals 19 degrees minus 50 degrees divided 2 equals 65 degrees. The wavelength calculated from 3.3, assuming n equals 1, is lambda equals 1.65 angstrom. The de Broglie wavelength of 54 electron volt electrons calculated from 3.2 is lambda equals h divided p equals 1.65 angstrom. The Prescheff agreement will give a quantitative confirmation of the de Broglie's relation between lambda, p and h. The breadth of the observing peak in figure 3.2 is easily understood. Also, for low energy electrons cannot penetrate deeply into the crystal, so that only a small number of atomic planes contribute to the diffracted wave. Hence, the diffraction maximum is not sharp. Indeed, all of the experimental results were excellent qualitative and quantitative agreement with the de Broglie prediction, and they provided convincing evidence that the material particles move according to the laws of wave motion. In 1927, Thomson showed the diffraction of electron beams passing through thin films and independently confirmed the de Broglie relation lambda equals h divided p in detail. Whereas the Davison-German experiment is like laws in X-ray diffraction, reflection from the regular array to atomic planes in a large single crystal, Thomson's experiment is similar to the Debye-Hall-Scherer method of powder diffraction of X-rays, transmission through an aggregate of very small crystals oriented in random. Thomson used higher energy electrons, which are much more penetrating, so that many hundred atomic planes contribute to the diffractive wave. The resulting diffraction pattern has a sharp structure. In figure 3.4, we show for comparison an X-ray diffraction pattern and an electron diffraction pattern from polycrystalline substance in which a large number of microscopic crystals are oriented at random. It is interesting that J.J. Thomson, who is 1897, discovered the electron, which he had characterized as a particle with a definite charge to mass ratio, and was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1906, was the father of G.P. Thomson, who in 1927 experimentally discovered electron diffraction and was awarded the Nobel Prize with Davison in 1937. Max Jammer writes of this: one may feel inclined to say that Thomson, the father, was awarded the Nobel Prize for having shown that the electron is a particle, and Thomson, the son, for having shown that the electron is a wave. Not only electrons, but all material subjects, charged or uncharged, show wave-like characteristics in their motion under the condition of physical optics. For example, Estermann, Stern and Frisch performed quantitative experiments on the diffraction of molecular beams of hydrogen and atomic beams of helium from a lithium fluoride crystal, and Fermi, Marshall and Zinn showed interference and diffraction phenomena for slow neutrons. In figure 3.5, we show a neutron diffraction pattern for a sodium chloride crystal. Even an interferometer operating with electron beams has been constructed. The existence of matter waves is well established. It is instructive to note that we had to go to the relatively long de Broglie wavelengths to find experimental evidence for the wave nature of matter. For both large and small wavelengths, both matter and radiation have both particle and wave aspects. The particle aspects are emphasized when the emission or absorption is studied, and the wave aspects are emphasized when their behavior in moving through a system is studied. But the wave aspects of their motion become more difficult to observe as their wavelengths become shorter. Once again, we see the central role played by Planck's constant h. If h were 0, then in lambda equals h divided p would obtain lambda equals 0 in the all circumstances. All material particles will then always have a wavelength smaller than any characteristic dimension, and diffraction effects could never be observed. Also, the value of h is definitely not 0. It is small. It is the smallness of h that obscures the existence of matter waves in the macroscopic world, for we must have very small momenta to obtain measurable wavelengths. For ordinary macroscopic particles, the mass is so large that the momentum is always sufficiently large to make the Broglie wavelengths small enough to be beyond the range of experimental detection, and classical mechanics reigns supreme. The wave-particle duality. In classical physics, energy is transported either by waves of the other by particles. Classical physics observed water waves carrying energy over the water surface or pellets, transferring energy from gun to target. From such experiences, they built a wave model by certain macroscopic phenomena and a particle model for other macroscopic phenomena, and they quite naturally extended these models into visually less accessible regions. Thus, they explained sound propagation in terms of a wave model and pressure of gases in terms of a particle model, kinetic theory. Their successes continued then the aspect that all entities are particles or waves. Indeed, this success extended into early 20th century with application of Maxwell's wave theory to radiation and the discovery of elementary particles of matter such as the neutron and positron. Hence, classical physicists were quite underprepared to find that the understanding radiation, they needed to evoke a particle model in some situations as the Compton effect and a wave model of other situations as the diffraction of X-rays. Perhaps more striking is the fact that the same wave particle quality applies to matter as well as to radiation. The charge-to-mass ratio of the electron and its ionization trail in matter as sequential localized collisions suggests a particle model, but electron diffraction suggests a wave model. Physicists now know that they are compelled to use both models for the same entity. It is very important to note, however, that in any given measurement, only one model applies. Both models are not used under the same circumstances. When the entity is detected by some kind of the interaction, it acts like a particle in the sense that is localized when it is moving in X, like a wave in the sense that interference phenomena are observed, and of course a wave is extended, no localized. Niels Bohr summarizes the situation in his principle of complementarity. The wave and particle models are complementary. If a measurement proves the wave character of radiation of matter, then it is impossible to prove the particle character in the same measurement, and conversely. Which model we use is determined by the nature of the measurement. Furthermore, our understanding of radiation or matter is incomplete unless we take into account measurements which reveal the wave aspects and also those that reveal the particle aspects. Hence, radiation and matter are not simply waves nor simply particles. A most general and to the classical mind, a more complicated model is needed to describe their behavior. Even though, in extreme situations, a simple wave model or a simple particle model may apply. The link between wave model and particle model is provided by probability interpretation of the wave-particle duality. In the case of radiation, it was Einstein who united the wave and particle theories. Subsequently, Max Born applied a similar argument to unit wave and particle theories of matter. Uncertainty principle. The use of probability considerations is not foreign to classical physics. Classical statistical mechanics makes use of the probability theory, for example. However, in classical physics, the basic laws, such as Newton's laws, are deterministic, and statistical analysis is simply a practical device for threatening very complicated systems. According to Heisenberg and Bohr, however, the probabilistic view is the fundamental one of the quantum physics, and determinism must be discarded. Let us see how this conclusion is reached. In classical mechanics, the equations of motion of a system with given forces can be solved to give us the position and momentum of the particle at all values of the time. All we need to know are the precise position and momentum of the particle at some value of the time t equals zero, the initial conditions, and the future motion is determined exactly. This mechanics has been used with great success in the macroscopic world. For example, in the astronomy to predict the subsequent motions and objects in the terms of their initial motions. Note, however, that in the process of making observations, the observer interactions with the system. An example from complementary astronomy is the precise measurement of the position of the moon by bouncing radar from it. The motion of the moon is disturbed by the measurement, but due to the very large mass of the moon, the disturbance can be ignored. The situation is somewhat similar to that existing in the Bohr's relativity theory. Physicists spoke of length intervals and time intervals, i.e. spaces and time, without asking critically how one actually measured them. For example, they spoke of the simultaneity of two separated events without even asking how and what would physically go about establishing simultaneity. In fact, Einstein showed that the simultaneity it was not absolute concept of all, as had been assumed previously, but that the two separated events that are simultaneous to one observer occur at different times to another observer moving with respect to the first. Simultaneity is a relative concept. Similarity. Then we must ask ourselves how they actually measure position and momentum. Can we determine by actual experience by the same instant both the position and momentum of matter or radiation? The answer given by quantum theory is not more accurately than the allowed by Heisenberg uncertainty principle. There are two parts of this principle, also called by indeterminacy principle. The first has to do with the simultaneous measurement of position and momentum. It states that experiment cannot simultaneously determine the exact value of the component of momentum p sub x, say, of a particle, and also exact value of its corresponding coordinate x. Instead, our precision of the measurement is inherently limited by the measurement process itself, such that delta px multiplied delta x bigger and equals to h bar divided 2, where the momentum px is known within an uncertainty of delta px and the position x of the same time to the within the uncertainty delta x. Here h bar is a shortened symbol for the h divided 2 multiplied p, where is h is the Planck's constant, that is h bar equals h divided 2 multiplied p. There are corresponding relations for other components of momentum, namely delta px y, delta y bigger and equals than h bar divided 2, and delta pz, delta z bigger and equals than h bar divided 2, and for angular momentum as well. It is important to realize that the principle has nothing to do with improvements in instrumental leading to better simultaneous determination of px and x. Reger of the principle says that even the ideal instruments, we can never in principle to do better than delta px multiplied delta x bigger and equals than h bar divided 2. Note also that the product of uncertainties is involved, so that, for example, the more we modify an experiment to improve our measure to px, the more we give up ability to determine x accurately. If px is known exactly, we know nothing at its. Hence, the restriction is not on the accuracy to which x or px can be measured, but on the product delta px multiplied delta x in a simultaneous measurement of both. The second part of the uncertainty principle has to do with the measurement of the energy E and the time t required for the measurements, as for example the time interval delta t during which a photon of energy spread delta E is emitted from the atom. In this case, delta E multiplied delta t bigger and equals h bar divided 2, where delta E is the uncertainty in our knowledge of the energy E of a system, and delta t the time interval characteristic of the rate of change in the system.